we have with us Mother Agnes and Sister Carmen. And they are, as I said, champions of peace. And on behalf of St. Peter Church, on behalf of the diocese, we express our thankfulness and gratitude. I know Mother will speak in Arabic, in French, and in English, but I know that you excel in the language of love and peace. So the floor is yours.
Dear brothers and sisters, I am very honored, very happy and impressed to be here among you for this holy liturgy. We have been now united in one bread and one blood of Jesus Christ. I have a deep respect and esteem for the Holy Church of Armenia. I know that Armenia was the first state in the world to be baptized and to receive Jesus Christ as his King. And you have been so faithful to your Christian identity that today, after 2014 years, that Jesus came to save us, you still conserve your holy language that was given to you by Saint Gregorius, the Illuminator. You still conserve your liturgy and you still conserve your traditions. Of course, you have been challenged through the ages with a lot of persecutions. I come back from Syria, where we visited with an international delegation of peace the survivors of Qara in the north of Syria. Once more, the Armenian community is paying a very heavy tax to sectarian wars that are financed by so-called Western powers. Once more, Aleppo has been destroyed, and the Armenian community in Aleppo had to flee. Once more, they had to flee, like their forefathers, fleeing during the Ottoman genocide, the Turkish genocide. Once more, Armenians, like other Syrians, had to flee. Some of them went back to Armenia. Some others are still in Syria, displaced in their own country. Some others went to Lebanon, and others maybe they came here to the United States or to any other country. And we asked, why every 10 to 20 years we are obliged to flee? Why do we have to face persecution, aggression, violations of human rights? As Christians, Jesus told us, they persecuted me, they will persecute you. I have here the fifth trumpet of the Revelation in the sixth chapter, where in the fifth trumpet, or they open the fifth seal, Saint John is saying, I saw under the altar the souls of those who were killed for the word of God and for justice. Will you wait until you take revenge for our blood from those who are living on earth? And they have been given each one a black, a white dress, and they have been told to rest a very short time until the number of their brethren will come to completion, those who will be killed like them. We know that our forefathers, they have been killed, maybe for political reasons, but especially because they were Christian. And today we know that our brethren are killed, maybe for political reasons, but mainly because they are Christian. We need not to fear, as Bishop said. We need to renew our trust in Jesus Christ and to thank Him because He visits us with fire and trial so that we are purified. I believe in Jesus' purification. I believe that Christians need to be purified with fire, to be holy, to be good witnesses, to be good brothers and sisters of Jesus, to have the life and the spirit of Jesus inside them. That's why, dear brothers and sisters, now that more and more we hear about persecutions, every day in Damascus, in Homs, in Aleppo, in any village in Syria, mortars are shelled on innocent people. I visited myself in the Armenian school in Damascus. 65 children between 5 and 11 years. A mortar came upon them. They were just going out from the church and they were talking about their first communion. And the mortar came upon them. And I saw a little girl, the mortar cut her feet, 11 years old, less. And we are trying to bring her here to the United States to get good treatment and back feet for her. What did those children, what did they do to deserve a mortar of the school? You see the injustice, you see how much the big power, they pray and they claim they want the protection of the Syrian people, but they don't do anything to really protect the Syrian population. Did you hear any mainstream media talking about what happened to those children? Did you hear any media talking about how Manula was completely destroyed out of combat? It was not a battle, it was an invasion and an aggression. And Kassa, they said it's a battle, it was not a battle. In Qara, you didn't find maybe some policemen and very old policemen. You didn't find any army. They invaded Qara and they made an innocent population just run away the Armenian church of the cities of the city where they were waiting for help because they lost everything. They lost their houses, they lost their stores, they lost their properties, they lost their cars, they lost everything. They went out to Spuchan. What shall we do when we see those deeds that are against justice and equity? First, we have to pray. We need to pray for Syria. We need prayers for Syria. I really request prayers to Jesus for Syria. To break the darkness, to enlighten the darkness that is besieging this country. You will hear that what the big powers they want is freedom and democracy for Syria. It is not true. It is not true. What they want is the consequence of what they are doing. What they are doing is just destroying Syria. They are just destroying Syria. If not, why are they destroying urban places? Why are they destroying museums? Why are they destroying schools? Why are they destroying factories? Why are they destroying hospitals? Why? They are trying to destroy a country. Of course, they had errors. We don't say that there was not error. But the errors of the government is not a justification to destroy the country. And we say, we want Syria to continue living. And we want the people of Syria to have the right to live on their own soil and to get peace through dialogue and not through shells. I can tell you that through the reconciliation work we are doing since 2 years, not only us, but a lot of people in Syria. Many things are progressing in Syria, between Syrian and Syrian. Even opposition members inside Syria, they open their eyes and they say, what we want is not the destruction of Syria, but to continue the government so that we don't have a void, we don't have a chaos. But from outside, a lot are trying just to dismantle and to discredit these initiatives of peace and reconciliation. Your prayers are very much important. Also, the testimony of the Armenian lobby group in Washington is important to say here to the United States says there is another way to help freedom and democracy in Syria out of any foreign interference, especially foreign fighters. The foreign fighters that have invaded Gaza come from Chechnya. They come from Saudi Arabia. They come from Libya and from many other countries. It's not the way to propagate democracy and freedom in Syria. All the contrary, those people are spreading terror. We need to let the US understand what we want is real democracy and freedom and human rights, and not a title, and behind the title, what we have is takfiri groups, fundamentalistic group, coming to fight jihad in Syria. That's what they say. In Syria, and they are killing innocent, they are destroying peaceful countryside, and they are finally demolishing all the culture and all the heritage and all the infrastructure in Syria. I am very happy to be with you. I would like always to draw your attention on the real stories about Syria. Do not hear and believe the mainstream media stories about Syria, because they are biased. They want to justify the destruction of Syria with false pretext. Is there any pretext to invade Gaza? Was Gaza a locality that was pro-Assad? I doubt. The inhabitants of Gaza were neutral. They were apolitical. They were just peaceful citizens living peacefully out of any partnership with anyone. And they were invaded. And their countryside was spoiled. And until today, we have the most extremist factions of jihadists that are invading and are in control of Gaza. The same in Sadat, the Syrian countryside in house. They were paying to the rebels to have peace. Nevertheless, they were invaded, and 16 of their churches were demolished or burned. And like this, all over Syria, in Yaqubi, in Ghassani, in Raqqa, in Taibe, in Ras El Ain, everywhere, and I don't tell you in Damascus or in Aleppo or in Homs or in Hama, I can't tell you how many of your brethren Christians are persecuted. On the 2 million of Christians that are living in Syria, 1,250,000 are displaced. We are following Iraq. They want an ethnic and religious cleansing in Syria, so that we have a monolithical society without any violence. We want to say here that Syria must remain pluralistic. They must stop fueling any sectarian factions coming to make jihad in Syria. They must stop destroying the infrastructure of Syria. You can do it with your prayer. You can do it with those who represent you here in the government. And to finalize, I would also request your help. In Syria, you have more than 10 million people that are displaced. They are in bad need for help. We have to help them to resist, remain in Syria, to rebuild Syria, because Syria is a turning point in the Middle East. We don't want that Syria become like Afghanistan. So we need ambulances. We need ambulances because people are dying without an ambulance to carry them to hospital. We need milk for children. There is no milk for babies in Syria. So I ask you those 2 things. And I will be in contact with your pastors so that any donation you will receive will arrive to the right people in the right way. I thank you. May the Lord bless you, and may the Lord bless and protect Syria. Thank you for your audience. God bless you.
This is a small gift from HPLC. It's the icon of Christ. God bless you. Our lives are with you, and I know it's touching whatever you said, and it really touches our hearts. But we encourage you, I need the congregation to give you a surprise. Mother Agnes-Mariam.